I'm from Bell. He is, was born in September, I don't know if you want to know the actual date, in early 70s, at various homes, in around Valparaiso, Indiana, and most of his mom's family is in Chicago, where I lived in that area for a couple of years. Then he moved to Las Vegas, where he got a lot of his working career started with several jobs. One was with Napoli Restaurant, and Domino's Pizza started in 1991. This is one of the things you really need to recognize, is that he is the second busiest Domino's in the entire USA, what he's doing here in Hawaii and otherwise. So that's pretty exciting. And some of his stores are on this island, and are some of the busiest in the world. There are over 10,000 Domino's Pizza stores worldwide. So this is pretty exciting to have him here sharing some of his story. He started as a trainee at Domino's, and then became a franchisee and got very involved. If you've seen the flyer, he has a wonderful family. We'll look forward to maybe meeting him on another occasion, but please join me in welcoming Mike to be here with us today.
All right, so
he's going to talk down here, so listen up real carefully, and he is going to ask or be repeating your questions as well, so that we can all hear pretty well. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks. All right, so I'll take this off now. So I only have about 30 minutes, right? And so I'm trying to take you from where I've been and what I've gone through, and then all the way through business in 30 minutes, and it's been 22 years. So I'll do the best I can. As Richard mentioned, so I started in Domino's Pizza January 11th of 1991. I was a 19-year-old kid. I was trying to put myself through, well, I was really just trying to attend college as much as I could. I actually went to UNLV during the years of our championship years. So if you know anything about the basketball team, we never really went to class. So, I was just trying to pay for myself to go to school. I got this job at Domino's and started working there. As a kid growing up, I'd always wanted to own my own business. Never knew how that would lead me, right? And so most of you might be here because there's going to be free pizza afterwards, which is cool, whatever gets you here, right? When I started to attend my first church, I was about 7 years old. I used to go to school there, and then they would have service also on Sunday. And I used to go there, well, I went there the first time, and they had free donuts, right? So I was like, I'm coming back every Sunday. And so they never had them again, but it got me into the Word, right? So however you get here is all that matters. Once you're here, right, then you can do something with it. So through Domino's, worked with various positions in Domino's from 91 until 98. 97, I was operating my store, and we used to work long hours, you know. The managers still work long hours. And it was the middle of the night, and I was in the back of my store, and I was looking at my P&L, my profit and loss statement. And I said, you know, if I just owned this one store for the year, I would have made $275,000. And to me, at that time, the money was the most important, I'll be honest. The money was important. And so I thought, well, that's why I want to do it. You know, God had a different plan for me, but I wasn't aware of that at that time, right? So I decided at the end of 97 that I would franchise. And I went to several areas and tried to find stores. In Las Vegas, it's a corporate market. It was all corporate stores, so I had to go other places. So I ended up buying a store there in San Francisco in 1998. I bought two stores. They were really the worst stores in the region, and those were the stores that I could afford. So I bought those stores, and over the course of 8 years, took them from, you know, the worst stores to better stores, and we were doing real well. And sometime in the middle of, it was about May or June of 2005, the gentleman that owned the stores here in Hawaii asked me if I wanted to buy the stores, and I told him, no way. Everybody knows not to buy the stores in Hawaii. That's like the plague. The stores were horrible. They were the worst market. Everybody tried to get out. We had some of the largest ownership groups that owned the stores in Hawaii, but no one was successful. The corporation owned the stores. The gentleman who owned, I'm sure if you've been in Hawaii, you've heard of the Higa name. His family that owned all the stores, 275 Domino's Pizza stores in Japan, they owned the stores. The Canadians, 250 stores at that time, they owned the stores. And then my buddy owned the stores, and he was trying to dump them on me, but I was way too smart for that, right? So I said, no, I have no reason to go to Hawaii. But I was running these stores in downtown San Francisco, and we lived in downtown. I don't know if anybody's ever visited downtown San Francisco, and I always say it's a great place to visit, but it's just not a great place to live. It's not a great place to raise kids. And so my son, the oldest was getting to be about 11 or 12. And he would stay up a little bit later, and then we would go out or whatever, and we'd come back home. And we had this nice three-flat building in downtown. And so he got to be about the age where he said, hey, why are all those girls out there in the middle of the night? And so then I said, all right, it's time to go. So at about, you know, at that time, right, is where I basically prayed, said, hey, you know, God, unless my kids go through everything I went through in order to get to where I'm at, how will they survive? How will they survive the world? Right? John 10:10, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. So I was at that part, like, how are they gonna get through all of this like I went through? My oldest boy was super passive. You know, by the time I was 20 years old, I had a good 152 fights under my belt. This kid never fought in his life. How's he gonna ever do that? So that was my first prayer. And then that was in late 2005. And then all of a sudden, my buddy who owned the stores here, his father passed away in India. And so in India, it's a 30-day mourning process. And I told him, hey, look, I'll go to Hawaii and look after the stores for you. I'll do my best to make sure that they get the most amount of money to the bank, but I can't guarantee anything, but I'll just do the best I can. So he went off for that, and I spent a couple of weeks here in Hawaii. And so everybody has their own opinion on why the stores weren't successful here. Until you get here, right, you really don't know. And so we just assumed, well, nobody probably eats pizza in Hawaii. They probably just eat other stuff, right? Until I got here and saw that there was pizza stores on every corner. I said, no, they're eating pizza. They're just not eating Domino's pizza. And so in that time, which later I would learn, right, God was working within me to recognize the opportunities in that business. And so I saw the opportunity. He came back, the owner, and we talked. And originally he wanted to be a partner, but then I wanted to invest in the stores, and he didn't want to put any more money in the stores, so he no longer wanted to be my partner. But over the course of that 6 months, I would go back and forth managing my stores in San Francisco and here and trying to figure it out. So right around that time, I decided, you know, I saw how it was. I was explaining to Leigh that we didn't lock our door, right, when I first rented the first place. We didn't have to lock our door here. It wasn't anything like San Francisco. We had this flat in downtown, the building. On top of it was a huge billboard. And so graffiti artists would climb up there in the middle of the night every night, do whatever they wanted to do, and then jump on my roof. So I'd wake up to that every night, like, oh, it's another graffiti artist up there, right? And so, you know, it was definitely a different life in Hawaii compared to that. And so when I got here and said, look, to my wife, hey, we're just going to move to Hawaii. We're just going to do this. We're going to sell our stores in San Francisco, and I think that that's where we should be, and there's huge opportunity there. So I started out in Domino's $5 an hour, just like everybody else. You know, I didn't have any money. I saved up my 401k when I was 19. You know, I started making, we would get salary and bonus, and so we'd get 20% of the store's profit as bonus. So as a 19-year-old kid, 20-year-old kid, 21-year-old kid, making $75,000 a year in the early 90s. It was pretty good money. Unfortunately, I was spending $75,001 a year, but, you know, you just go about and try to learn that lesson. And so I couldn't contribute to my 401k until I was 21. And so at the time I turned 21, I was contributing full force, as much as I could do. But when I was ready to buy a store, I really only had about $44,000 saved. And when you cash that out early, I $36,000, and I went and tried to get a loan. Couldn't get that loan on my own, and got a partner, and that's how I got that first store going. And the partner ended up being my buddy, who ended up owning the stores here. So when we were trying to negotiate a deal on these stores, I just saw a real unhealthy business. There was 10 stores at the time. I was back and forth for 6 months seeing what was going on. We had some misguided people that were working for us, and that is a direct correlation to the leadership. It's not to put anything on them. There should have been someone there to lead them and guide them in the proper manner and hold them to the standards morally and ethically to execute. And no one was doing that. So they were stealing and doing all kinds of bad things, and we just had to overcome that. So I saw the 10 stores and said, look, these 6 stores are somewhat healthy. I'll take over these 6 stores and do something with it. And since we don't have a lot of time, I'm going to cut the story short. Those 6 stores, when I bought them, losing about $600,000 a year. So I didn't have $600,000 to lose very long. I needed to get them to break even in a very short amount of time. So in that first year, I was able to get them to break even. They were averaging about $7,000 to $8,000 a week in sales, which is called AWUS, Average Weekly Unit Sales. And then we got those stores to break even, and they were building up sales, but the downside was is we stayed at break even for 3 years. One thing you'll learn as you start to own your own business and build your own business, break even sounds great when you're looking at somebody else's P&L and looking at, you know, you're running a company and we're break even, at least we're not losing money. But break even to a small business owner means that you're not making any money. You're not paying any of your bills with that money, and your savings will go quickly. And so the idea is not just to get to break even, but you're trying to be profitable. And so when we got those stores to break even, 3 years later, I was here. I believe that I was supposed to be here, and 3 years later, I was grinding it out. My family of four was living in a one-bedroom apartment above the old Wahiwa store. That still exists today. The store's not there, but the sign is there. If anyone's ever been on Kilani and Kilani Bakery, you were probably lost, but if you were over there, you just look up there and there's 3 one-bedroom apartments above that building that the old Domino's is in. And so my family of four was living in that one. My brother was living in the middle, and one of the managers that came with me from San Francisco was living on the end. And it was rough. We were grinding it out, and we were there for over a year trying to get somewhere. And so to you, with your foundation, you might think this is crazy, but 3 years after that first prayer, I said another prayer, and I said, you know, what am I doing wrong, God? I mean, I went here. I thought that's what you wanted me to do. We're running the business like what we should be running, but what am I doing wrong? And at that moment, it hit me that I really hadn't said a prayer in those 3 years. I hadn't done anything else to have guidance in the Word or have any kind of belief. And so that was right around, well, that was in 2009, right? And so it led me at that moment to make a decision to change my life. And whatever the result of that would be in my business was going to be secondary. And so the story caught up now. We did that. We started following the Word, and I'm going to share some things with you. And we started to believe in what the signs we were getting and how we should operate the business. And so that's how now, as Mr. Tanner said, we have the second busiest store in the country. We're in the top 10 in the world there at Schofield. We have some of the busiest stores in the world. Our store's average. Some of you may have gone to Haula. We just remodeled that store. We're in the process of remodeling. It'll be finished in the next week or two. And that's our new pizza theater image, and that's the stores that we're building. You know, since I've been here in the last 3.5 years, we've built every store new. We took over all these old stores and old locations that were just run down. We used to have this store in Kapahulu, and when I first came, first visiting, if anyone was here 7.5, 8 years ago or so, there was 40 days of rain, and it rained outside the store and inside the store for 40 days. And interesting, as you learn the word, right, 40 days, and anything 40 is about endurance. And that definitely was some enduring times, right? And so we were really just trying to make it. And so that was the last store that was the first store I wanted to move. It was the last store that we actually moved. And so just to give you some financial highlights, which is mildly irrelevant, but that we started out with this company that was losing $600,000 a year, and last year our EBITDA, everything before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. If you're familiar with that, actually a Domino's accounting person came up with that term, and it's widely used throughout the business world now. But EBITDA last year was $1.5 million. So we've turned the stores around, and then how do we do that, or how is that relevant to you? So I'm not going to be able to cover everything. This is my 4-year-old son's contribution to the presentation tonight. So there, you know, basically you have this business, right? What are you trying to get done? How do I use what my knowledge is right now and run a business? Because you're going to go to a bank, you're going to go to people, you're going to go everywhere, and they're going to say, well, what have you done? Well, you've only been an employee. Well, you've never run a business. We all go through that. But what you have to do, right, is it's all based around the principles of how you're going to run it. So you're going to have foundation, then we're going to go through this process. You're also eventually going to have to figure out your operations, your sales, and your profits. But we have such a short time, I'm going to start where you're at right now, right? So what is your foundation? You have a huge advantage over where I was at that time. And you just have to recognize that it's an advantage. And I don't know if all of you have been in the Word your whole life or most of your life, but you're a lot younger than I was when I was brought to the Word, right? I've only been involved, really actively involved, seeking the Word daily for the last 5 years. And so the foundation 14:6 said that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Except in business, you need to go to a class and they're going to teach you something else, right? No, that is the way, and we just have to recognize it, and then we have to figure out, as we stay in the Word, those things that we're looking for will be prevalent to us, right? We'll understand those things. And right now, you may have had an idea about your business, right? Or you saw something that said, hey, you know, I got this great idea for a business. Let me tell you, ideas, they come every day. But if you're going to make a business out of it, you need something more than that. You need a real plan. That idea, right, may have given you a plan, and you start thinking through this plan, but a lot of times that idea is our thought. And we have to recognize whether our thought is in alignment with what God wants us to do, or whether it's just our thought and we think it's a great idea and we're going to make millions of dollars doing it. So the idea, right, 32, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free, right? And so in order to get that freedom is from everything. All the turmoil and everything that you're thinking about now, like, oh, I only got a year or two, I got to start my business, I got to go back to my country. I thought the opportunity to come here was huge because so many countries are represented here. And as a kid growing up in Las Vegas, there's a huge Mormon community there, and all my friends participated, and I always thought, wow, it's pretty cool that they got to go on this mission. And some of them just got to go on a mission to downtown, which kind of sucked, but some of them got to go to a mission in all these other countries, right? And I thought, wow, that was just impressionable to me, that I thought, wow, that's pretty cool. And so, you know, I was hearing earlier that last year, you know, my family and I, we traveled every month of the year, and we were able to go to four different countries, and most of that was with Domino's, but all of it was, at least I would get to share, you know, some of the word whenever I was in that country, and that was a great opportunity. And going back, you know, a lot of years, you know, we never would have thought that was possible, but it was possible. And so, you know, that idea stage, make sure that when you're in that idea stage, that's really, you're taking direction from someone smarter than you, right? Someone with guidance, right? As you continue in the Word, you will know what is the right path for you. You may want to do this, or you may want to do that, but it's really important, because I wanted to do Domino's Pizza, and I wanted to do Domino's Pizza just because I would make a lot of money. And for 15 years, I worked in Domino's Pizza and didn't make any money. You know, theoretically, I would get a paycheck and we'd have this income, but I wasn't prosperous in the sense that God wanted me to be prosperous, and that was the real issue. And so it changed when we used to have these complex business plans, right? And you probably have to contribute or you have to turn in a complex business plan. But right now, my company runs off of one page, because we're in the era of 1,000-page employee manuals, in the era of, you know, 100-page business plans. But if you give an employee a 1,000-page business, you know, operating plan or employment plan, or they're not going to know any of it. But if you give them one page and get everybody focused on that, then you can really move mountains. You can really do something with it, because you have your whole team focused on that. Some of you might be here to build a business where you're the only one. I don't know anything about that, and I'm not the expert at that. I'm not going to talk about that at all, because my objective is to build large teams. Teams of people, give them opportunity to succeed and build themselves, and then as a team, we would defeat the competition, and we would continue to move forward. So stage, make sure that idea, that you're recognizing that, and the only way to recognize that is just to continue in the Word daily. And then you have a plan. Once you make that plan and you've done everything to make sure that plan is right, take a moment to say, this plan won't work at all. This is the wrong plan altogether. What if I couldn't use any of the aspects of this plan and do a new plan? Talk a little bit about that, right? So believing action, right? As you thinketh, that Proverbs 23:7, as you thinketh, the man thinketh. That is who he is. So as you think that's what you can do, then you can do that. Philippians 4:13. Started 5 years ago, that's really the only verse I knew, and that was the one I wanted to start with. The name of my company, before I knew the word, is called Posso Pizza. Posso is a Portuguese word that says I can. It comes from the Bible. That wasn't me, trust me. That was God, right? I had no idea that I knew it meant I can. I didn't know where it came from. I didn't know the foundation of that, right? So I can do through Christ which strengtheneth me. And that's everything that you'll do is going to have to be around your believing action, right? You know, operations is going to be a plan based on the worldly things that you need to get accomplished. it should be a derivative of your foundation and how you guide your people. And then you have sales, something to think about in 3 John 2, which was one of the second most prevalent verses in my life in the early days as a new man, right? And that was that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. So prosperity, not just in I could pay my bills and have some financial prosperity, but really prosperous in my life in all categories, that I have time with my family and I could raise my children and I can devote my life to my, you know, to my wife with God, and that the byproduct of that would be a prosperous business. It would give us the revenue we needed. And and then when you come down, when the circle is almost full, as you're coming down, after you have done all these things, then you get to think about profits, and that's a long time away. But what the great thing about the profitability is, you should, at least that's what your doctrine is from what I learned growing up, is that you're really good at the tithe. And that's, believe it or not, extremely important. And not only the tithe, but abundant sharing. Abundant sharing is sharing of your first fruits. Not like the 10% after everything's paid, but like your new fruits that you have just grown, that you would share that before you know what you're going to do with the rest. And that's one thing that has blessed my family tremendously, is just contributing. Contributing, knowing that, hey, you know what? God knows what to do with this money better than I do, and I'm going to contribute that, and in return, He will be my sufficiency, and He will take care of all my needs. And so a lot of times people get in business, and I don't know your situation individually, but I know there's a lot of people, so probably fall in this category, that you have your believing life, and then you have your life, and I want to be separated from my believing. You can do that. I'll tell you what. Your life is your life. Some of you don't know what to do. You might be in your early 20s, not have any business experience whatsoever, but know that you're driven to have a business. The only thing that is going to get you through, because it's not going to be the bankers, it's not going to be other entrepreneurs, it's not going to be, you know, other business people. The only thing that is going to get you through all that is the Word of God. No doubt about it. At that time, when we were in that situation and we were ready to either go bankrupt or just give up, that was the only salvation that I had, and my responsibility as the leader in the family, that's the only salvation my family had. They might not have known it at that time. I didn't share those dark secrets at that time because it was a humbling experience. It was tough. You know, one thing that you'll never have to go through, but I almost did, is to tell my wife that we were going to fail. We were not going to be successful. And so God gave me a way out, and every day I thank God for that. Because without that, you know, obviously I wouldn't have the opportunity to share with you, and you wouldn't have the opportunity to move a business that you'll do the same thing. So Malachi 3:10-11, right, it talks about the tithe. It says, hey, what you do that, don't worry about where it goes or what happens or whatever, but I'm going to open a window that's going to pour down so many that you will not be able to contain them in your storehouse. And that's really, If you start with the foundation that your business is going to be the way in which you word, you're gonna receive all those promises. And so it's here. So that start at the bottom here, right? So you had that plan, right? And so that plan, sometimes that's of you, right? And these verses here are about, hey, you know, of my own self I can do nothing. I'm not here to do my own will. If you want to, because that's what you want to do, just take a second look at that. Make sure that that's what God wants you to do, and make sure that you know, you're listening, and how you listen is continuing the Word daily, right? And so again, it's surrounded by believing action. Your plan, once you're done with that plan, write a new plan based on everything else that you did think about in that first plan. Think of something else. And Acts 17:11, right? These were more notable than those in Thessalonica. That's you guys. In that they searched the Word daily to find out whether those things were so or not. And so continue in the Word, figure out that, and you'll be able to hear messages. You'll be able to take guidance because you've humbled yourself to the Word. You can do it on your own. Trust me. I did it on my own, and I had worldly success. For behind the curtain, the company and those other stores and the other franchisees didn't know that we were struggling and we were failing and we weren't succeeding in the way that we were supposed to succeed. And we had no enrichment in our life. And just take it as a benefit that you're here in this institution right here and now. Because in my life, I would have never imagined that I would have been in here and step foot in here and be able to be here today. After that, then you make your final plan. And you can use those together. And as you learn, you know, what you should be looking out for, in between that new plan and that final plan, again, you just have to be cognizant of the fact that the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. Utterly destroy, steal the word of God, and he does not want you to succeed. And there's going to be people out there that he's going to use. And there's going to be everything, every situation of the world that's going to come in contact with you. When you know you're ready for business is when you know no matter what, beyond a shadow of a doubt, those obstacles, then you're prepared. You know, I can't tell you what business to be in. I can't tell you where you should go other than go to the Word. Because there is somebody, there is our Heavenly Father that can show you the way, right? And that's the only way to get to where you need to. Ask those people that have never done it or don't have the success or the prosperity in life that you're looking for. You ask those people, they're going to give you all the negative. Take those, understand them. You can. More greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. So you can accept that. You could. Comment. All right. Final plan, right? That final plan is really when you decide, okay, can I do this? Is this the right business for me? And am I in the right spot? So, 17, that the man of God, this is God's wish for us, that the man of God may be perfect. It's the Greek word, artios, yeah? That means not only perfect, but thoroughly furnished.
Ship that's going to the sea that's not going to be around anywhere for 6 or 7 months. They need to have everything. They couldn't have forgotten anything at home. You know when you go to class and you forget something at your dorm and you run back? Yeah, that can't happen when they're at sea. Okay? So this is what you're going to go through. You just have to be prepared. Fully equipped, outfitted, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. If your objective is to do good unto your fellow man, you're going to have success. You're going to have success in business or whatever.
Some of you might feel point when you recognize that God's wish for you is not to be a small business owner. He might have another plan for you. And you might feel bad, but understand this, that you should feel great for you. And that plan might not have been exactly what
when you started this class or when you signed up or maybe just came for free pizza, but that you would be able to know that you recognize that, hey, you know what, this business was not going to work out for me, but I'm going to go and follow God's plan instead of my plan, right? And so it revolves around that same believing action, always. And so some of the things that you should know about the law of believing, right? And we start over here in what's available. So you have to know what's available, right? What is available when I want to start my own business? Do I have to have these five senses things covered? You do have to have those five senses things covered. You have to have some physical things going. But, you know, what's available, right? In 2 Corinthians 9:18, it says, hey, God will be your sufficiency in all things. And then all sufficiency in all things, right? So twice it repeats it, all sufficiency in all things. It's establishing it, right? Two or twice establishing it. All sufficiency in all things, including business. And sometimes my brothers and sisters in business get it wrong. And a lot of times that happens, and that's something that we have to recognize and love them up and just hopefully guide them in the way in which we're really meant to succeed and we're really meant to have. And then how to receive it. How am I going to receive what God says about me and what direction I'm supposed to take? You know, a great way to start is with meekness in your heart or being humble and understanding that there's a being there that has a better plan than you do. And even though you want to do these things, that you're open and you're willing to do that. All right? And the law of believing, right, what to do with it? Galatians 6:10 is my time here with you, right? Therefore, as I have opportunity, I'll do good unto all men. not just believers, but all men, but especially the household of faith, right? And so that's my opportunity when somebody asks me, I never know why. They had no idea that I had any foundation in the Word whatsoever. But God knew, right? God knew what was going on, and He worked that out. And so that's my sharing on what to do with it. Your needs and wants in parallel, that doesn't say your greed and want in parallel, right? Needs and wants, something that you're actually working towards in your business plan is not only a want, but it's also a need, that He will fulfill your need, right? Ask anything according to His will. Not your will, but ask anything according to His will, and He shall, provide it, and He shall be with you. And so, you just have to make sure that's where you're at, mentally, physically, spiritually, that you're ready for that. And, it sounds like just a number of years, right? When I throw out a year, like, for the last 22 years, I've been in Domino's Pizza. And for the first 17, I struggled like crazy. It's just years. But when it's your life, it's day by day. And it's a long, arduous process. And you just have to be willing to grind it out and overcome. There's going to be obstacles. You're going to have to overcome those obstacles. There's going to be, naysayers. There's going to be the thief. And you just have to be prepared for that. In business, it's a constant struggle. We have great times, but we just had a meeting with my managers the other day. And so we have 11 stores on this island. 3 of the stores were bought by people that came with me to build up this market. The store in Eva Beach, if you ever go down there, is a gentleman named Kelly White. He came with me from San Francisco. I told him not to come. I told him, this project is going to be bigger than you're used to. It's going to be tougher than you're thinking, and you're not going to... He wasn't there in the early days of my stores in downtown. It's not going to be something easy to overcome. He came anyways, for whatever reason, and he lived in that other one-bedroom apartment, him, his wife, and his little son at that time. And so when it came an opportunity to Galatians 6:10, I sold him that store in Eva Beach. And he's been prosperous in that store. At the time I sold him that store at Eva Beach, Little Caesars wanted to buy that store. Little Caesars wanted to come in when I was about three and a half years into it. They wanted to come in, and the gentleman offered me $100,000 to buy that store. And I had lived my whole life competing against the competitors. It was very difficult to make that decision. And so at the time I was thinking about selling that store because it was out there. I couldn't spend time there. I wasn't spending time there, and I was spending more time at the other stores. Kelly called me and said, hey, if I want to buy that Eva Beach store, how much will you sell to me for, and will you finance me, and this, that, and the other? And so at that moment, I had just started in the Word, but God had touched my heart and said, hey, you know what, Kelly? If you want that store, if you work as hard for you as you have for me, and do everything that you've done to build up my store for you and your family, I'll sell you the store for $1, but you better be working every day, and you better earn it, you better bust butt. And so he did that, and that store was losing $3,000 a month for me. So I didn't sell him anything, right? I didn't give him anything. I gave him a rotten egg. But it was an opportunity for him to do something with it, and he did do something with it, and the store averages about $25,000 a week now, and he has a great life with his family, and he's able to do that. The other gentleman that owns the other two stores, he worked in whatever store we had to go, and whatever store we needed to be at, and whatever the fire was that we needed to put out, that's where he was. And so he worked for me for 5 years, and so he bought the store that services the UH campus. There's a store at the food court, and then there's a store outside, which is on Baratania. And so he's been very prosperous in those two stores, and he just won. In this past year, he won what's called the $2 million club, the first time a store does over $2 million in a year. And so he's been prosperous in that. The other 8 stores I currently own, some of you may know Jody here that runs the store. She is operating partner there. Eventually, she will own that store, her and Roger on their own. Right now, she's my operating partner in that store. And what we try to do is just build up more stores and give more opportunity. And I'm not easy to work for. I'm not easy to, say, a lot of people come into these interviews, want to get paid a lot of money, and want to own a store in a year. That sounds great. It just doesn't happen that way. You have to, you really have to earn it. You have to work hard. You have to grind it out, and you have to earn it. You have to be the right person in the right situation, and I have to be able to recognize that. And my eyes are wide open, right? When I say that the thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, and destroy, it's not to scare you. We're supposed to have no fear. It's to just be eyes wide open. And so my responsibility as a leader in the company and working with these young men and women that we're trying to develop it up into leaders and be able to lead a store and eventually lead their own store and then have success on their own. So Kelly and Ken's, to me, is not successful because they did a whole lot of sales and they did a whole lot of profits. In order for me to judge them as successful, I want to see them give the same opportunity to somebody else that I gave to them. And then, to me, they will have been successful. So, needs and wants in parallel, God's ability always equals God's willingness. You know, as He's able and He's willing to do all that you need, you have to rely on that. You have to pay attention to that. You have to make sure that you know that. How are we on time? So, you know, I want to just close out, if you don't mind, and I'll read Ephesians 3:16 there, and then you can ask me any questions you like. When you're asking questions, I have no idea what business you should be in. Just keep that in mind. But I know where you can go. Okay? So, you know, what God says about you, that He, God, would grant, give you, I can do all things, right? He will give you according to the riches of His glory. Not how much money you have starting in business. Not how much knowledge you have of worldly things and whatever business you're going to do. But according to His riches of His glory, to be strengthened with might. And that's a Greek word, dunamis, right? Potential power. Dunamis is just sitting there on the shelf until you do something with it. That's why it's so important to have believing action. That not only you believe in your heart, but you take action. Your part is the action part. I'll repeat that. Your part is the action part. Make sure you take action. Because the greatest ideas, the greatest business plans, and the greatest things to solve all the worldly problems, most of those sit in the grave right now. Because a believer didn't take action. And so the main thing to know is that, hey, we have all these things. I think the story of how Mr. McKay, and I don't know if you address him a different way, but Mr. McKay decided for this place to be in the middle of nowhere in a sugarcane field. It's crazy if you think about it. It's crazy, but he took believing action. Even for 30 years where he wasn't allowed to take believing action, he held on to that knowing that God did not present him that opportunity to do nothing with it. That one day you guys would sit here, having been the 60th class or so that comes through, and that you would be able to go out and move the world, and that millions of people would come to the middle of a sugarcane field for no apparent reason whatsoever. And that 65 million people came through the PCC, and you had your opportunity to move their life. So, back to Ephesians 3:16. That He would grant you according to the riches of His glory to be strengthened with might, dunamis, right, potential power, by His Spirit in the inner man, the new man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge. Can do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. And just to continue in 21. Unto Him be glory in the church, by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Right? So, you know, that is what has blessed my life in the last 5 years. How we went from this company that really just was doing what we could do to survive, to being this prosperous company, giving opportunities to other people. And so, you know, my wish for you, obviously, besides 3 John 2, is be beloved above all things. I wish that you may be prosperous and in health, even as thy soul prospereth, but that you are able to perpetuate that to the next person that you can move that on. And so thank you for the opportunity to speak to you guys today, and hopefully it's something that that you can use moving forward in your life. Questions, great.
So I know that one day I'll be dealing with that situation. So how do you go about changing people's behaviors, telling people, and then refocusing?
Yeah, so that's a perfect question. That's a great question because that is very important. So you want to know how we change people's behavior that, you know, start out in one mindset and you need to meet your business objectives, right? So in that situation, right, you cannot control what they think or what they do, but you establish the standard. To me, the standard is the word of God, right? So I would act in the fashion of holding myself to those standards. And then I want to work with whoever wants to go with me. Like I always say, hey, you know what? I'm ready to work with whoever wants to run. Those guys that want to slowly get there, I don't have time for that in my life, in my business. So I always, recognize who is willing to run, who wants to maintain those standards. And hey, some of those people still existed in the company a year or two later that were just hanging out and doing all bad stuff. We would control them as much as possible until the point in which, you know, we would advance. So my company, this is the one page that we operate off of, and our mission statement is, exceptional team members and leaders on a mission to be the best pizza company serving and teaching in Hawaii. And so we recruit, hire, and train the best possible people, knowing that tonight we're going to have a dinner rush, and we need to field a team to handle that dinner rush. And we're going to field the best team possible for today, but we're looking to get better for tomorrow. So as we're working with those people, they're going to have the opportunity to change or stay the same. You know, 8 years ago, I brought some people here. Some of those people came to be delivery drivers and work as much as they could. 8 years later, they're still a delivery driver doing that same thing. I want them to see the light, but it's their choice to take it or not. It's their choice to build themselves up in the company. I'm going to present an opportunity, but of course, it's up to them to take it. So yeah, you're going to walk into a situation and don't cut out your eye, right, despite your face. You might need them to do what little they can do. But at some point, recognize they either need to make a decision. Whose team are you on? You're on my team, you're good, or you want to be on a different team. And if you're on that other team, at one point, I'm going to have to make the decision, say, hey, either they're going to make it because the pressures of our standards are so high that they just say, I quit, or you have to go to them as the leader sometimes and say, hey, this is the toughest thing I have to do in my job, but we've given you this opportunity. We've established a standard, right? You have the word, the standard, doctrine, reproof, correction. It's the same thing in business. You set the standard, you reproof them to the standard, and you never let them get outside the standard so that new standard creeps into the company, which is not the standard. So doctrine, reproof, correction works perfectly in business too. Here's the standard, here's where you got a standard, let's get back into the standard. Here you are on your own farm, you need to get back into that standard. All right, but thank you, great question. Is that it? Go ahead.
So you guys, what did you focus on? Promotions, it was all internal affairs, get your employees on one page, or?
Okay, yeah, that's great, another great question. You guys are much further off than I was, because I'm looking at it backwards, right? You guys are on the way there. So, right? If you've ever seen a local TV commercial, it was by accident, because we spent a lot of years just focusing on our business. So the question was, let me repeat that. No, I got it. So the question was, is that, what did we focus on in business in order to get us to that part? Was it promotions? Was it operations? What was it? So we started right here in the foundation, right? It was all about cleaning up our backyard. And if you notice on all these circles, they were incomplete, right? Until the end in which we had all things fulfilled, our company was incomplete. We still have to fill that in. But, so we didn't focus on sales. We focused on our house, our side of the business. When you're in business, this is your side. What your foundational beliefs are, what you'll set as standards in your company, what your business plan is, how you'll treat your people and how you'll build them up and identify leaders. Some of you might go into business and might not be a leader, but your responsibility is to find one, identify one, and make sure there's one there. And then your operations, how you handle your back of the house. So when you're driving down the street and you see a messy yard and you say, oh wow, look at that yard, it's all messed up. Go back to your own house and figure out what your yard looks like, right? And that's when we see our competition do things that we don't necessarily agree with. We'll be in a manager meeting and the managers will bring up, oh, I saw Papa John's guy do this, and I saw Pizza Hut guy do this, and I always have to bring them back in and say, hey, it's not about what they do, it's about what we do. Is our driver out there doing that thing? If one of my drivers has ever cut you off, that's what the brand that you think about my company is, and so we need to clean up our things. So I spend 95% of the time on what I think is 95% of the business, but it might look like half the circle. 95% of the business is all about what we do. The results is about what we do. We're gonna get sales. When we show something similar to this to our managers, we say, hey, you hang a sign on the door that says Domino's Pizza, right? In the mainland, the stores average, I won't say it because it's gonna be videotaped, but, so our stores, right, when you open up a store and you hang a sign on the door and hire some good people, you're gonna do between $5,000 and $10,000 a week in sales just from doing that. Because what the people's perception of Domino's Pizza is. When you get operations, another $5,000 to $10,000 a week. All those things are gonna result in sales. You do some sales building things, some simple five basics that everyone can do, that everyone in the company can focus on, another $5,000 to $10,000 a week in sales. Now all you math majors, figure this out. $5,000 to $10,000 a week in sales is 100% difference, right? What makes it so different? What makes it so different is how well the leader in that store executes the plan. And the window is huge. The reason why our company averages twice as much per store, per sales per week than 5,000 other stores on the mainland is because we're just trying to grind those things out better. We're just trying to execute those better, and my responsibility is just to keep the managers in line to do that. When I hire a manager, I don't hire the best person in the quick service business for the last 20 years. I'd rather hire a great person that has the potential to be a leader than anybody with any experience. Our store in Haula does 4 times as much as the store in Laie, the Pizza Hut in Laie. Why? It's in a better spot. It's a newer store until now, better location. Because Jody has the opportunity to own her own business. She has the opportunity to bless other people, not to mention that she was a BYUH grad. So the idea is that that we focus more on that side of the business and the rest will come. There are things to do, but I didn't do any of those things for a good 7 years. We did this side a lot more, and every once in a while. You will see a local commercial during the Super Bowl, having said that. But other than that, you won't see very much local media on promotions because the image you sell had better be the image that you represent. So you better get that representation of the brand ahead of time instead of later. So, thank you, good question. Both guys got a great question. Anyone else with a halfway decent question? So right now, Domino's is, she asked what Domino's is doing as far as all the competitors. Right now, Domino's is on a mission to be the number one pizza company in the world. And so that's why we have changed a lot of things. If you've noticed in the last 5 years, we not only changed, we're changing ourselves, as a representation of the company. We're doing these things better and then expect that these things will change, and they have. And so right now we're number two in that mission, and we have 3 to 5 years to get to that number one spot. And so we're working every day. Right now they just set up a new standard that all the stores, all 5,000 stores in the US and 10,000 stores worldwide would be a pizza theater image, like you can see over here in Haula, in this little place in the middle of nowhere, like this campus, and you see a store, and we're one of the early adopters. Right now I have 3 stores that are that pizza theater. We'd like to build a good four more stores this year, and there'll be that pizza theater concept as well. And so, that's where we stand right now, and that's our mission, is to be that. And we can put on any kind of great promotion, marketing plan, this, that, and the other, but if we're not a wholesome company trying to build people up, it won't happen. And so, it's my responsibility as one of the representatives, one of the leaders, to try to do this. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Well, say you want to be a franchise manager, would we contact someone like you that owns your own franchise, or would we go direct like corporate and see if we could?
Yeah, so that's a great question. If you want to be a franchise in any business, how do you go about doing it? You go straight to the franchisee, you go straight to the corporation, and those are great worldly thoughts, right? In the world, we're going to click on a website and go to the corporation, and then your document is going to be mixed in with 1,000 other documents, right? And so that happens a lot. People, I have this idea, plan, I'm I'm going to go be a franchisee. So I always recommend, in the way that, you know, the people that I work with is, hey, we go and work in that store. Look and see if it's something that I really want to do. You know, you have all these students that graduate from culinary school. Is anyone one of those? Good, because none of them can cook, right? But you have these people that go into a restaurant and learn. And my buddy, I got him set up in a restaurant here in Honolulu, and I was able to do that because he went, you know, 37 years ago, and studied in a kitchen and worked for free. And he went all over the world and worked in from the south of France, northern Italy, everywhere as an executive chef. But he started out working for free. Nowadays, unfortunately, we can't do that. But no, you learn, and you gives you more experience. You know, I would say I want to retire, but I don't want to retire and join a country club. I want to retire and be a starter so I can go for free, right? So there's two ways to go about doing it, but you have to think about what is best for you given your situation. And I would say, hey, you know what, go in there and do it. Do it for 30 days. You know, you can be excited about anything for 30 days. It's harder to be excited about it on day 31. You know, that's how the show Survivor, right, became so popular, is that, hey, you might be able to grind it out for 30 days. After that, it becomes hard. So you can go and work in one of those places. You're going to know in a short amount of time whether it was my plan or God's plan. So I didn't bring very many copies of this, but if you want, I'll leave one with Richard. I didn't think about that.
And then we can put that on.
Yeah, it's just simple stuff that I do in my business. It doesn't have great detail. I go into great detail with managers, but it's just some stuff that everybody can focus on, and that we always keep the mission and the team above all, so that we build wholesome, we build it right. You know, when our backyard is clean, we can go and fix other backyards, and that means more stores.
Guys, the pizza is quite here, so I have a couple of announcements, and then we'll take one more question while they're break. I'm sure they'll be here because they're anticipating being alive in 2 minutes. So, we actually, Mike is providing, we didn't pay for this, he's providing like 40 pizzas for you. I also wanted to just mention to you two other things. There's going to be a special Saturday long event here in this room on Saturday, the day after Valentine's Day. Some of you came. We filled this room with 85 plus people where we did crowdfunding. We're going to do a special event on valuing companies and knowing a little bit how to present yourself if you're looking for interviewing. And we're actually going to be getting some Domino's pizza for that event too.
Yay!
So you may want to put that at least on your calendar. Again, that will be February 15th in this room. It's an all-day event. We're actually flying a couple of people over here. It's free. Let me tell you what it is. These same people have presented at Stanford University, Berkeley, BYU Provo, and University of Texas. And I know this BYU Provo pays these guys $300 per student to hear what you get to come and hear it for free. So there's some pretty cool things that sometimes Willis Center is able to work out for you that are beneficial. It means you got to give us a Saturday if you want to learn some of those things, but it will really help you in understanding evaluation. It's kind of a precursor to the new course. You know, we have a minor now in entrepreneurship and small business. Our capstone course will be taught for the very first time next semester by Jason Curl. It's our $499 cash evaluation. So this week long, or this Saturday event, also kind of helps give you a taste of some of what you'll get in that capstone course for those of you that are working towards a minor. So we had a crowdfunding event, now we have a crowdfunding class. This will help you understand cash evaluation in a class that I wish I could have taken when I was undergraduate or my MBA program. That's how good I think this ENCR 499 class will be. So hopefully this Saturday seminar will be something you'd like to come to. So I just want to mention that to you. There's one other thing that some of you may not be aware of. As of yesterday, it is now part of the honor code that nobody wear hats anywhere indoors. So a couple of you are wearing them. You need to take them off, but we have to report to the honor code. So don't wear it inside any building. It became effective. It was in the bulletin yesterday. Please just recognize that. We're used to wearing hats, not indoors anymore. In fact, I had Mike take this off. He was, yeah, it is. And I said, Mike, it just passed yesterday. Sorry. He was going to be wearing it. And I said, Mike, you know what? This just was posted yesterday. So you guys all need to be aware of that going forward. Okay.
See how attentive I was to regroup?
So, I don't know, Steve, do you know if it's here yet? Okay, so they're just pulling down there. Let's take one more question, because if you all go down there right now, it's not all on the table. But if you come down these stairs here and go just outside the back door. Let's take one more question. Who wants to ask something? Mike, one other question. Anything else?
No, yeah, I'm not sure. He asked, I was talking about the Word of God and then some other word. I'm not sure what that other word is. The only word I have is that Word of God, so maybe it's just my bad English.
Let's thank the camera.